Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Prelims High Yielding Series for Prelims 2020, and the topic for today's video is Enemy Properties. The reason why this particular news item is important is because of the recent news item wherein a group of ministers headed by Union Home Minister decided to monitor the disposal of 9,400 enemy properties, which the government estimates are of 1 lakh crore value. So what are these enemy properties and why are they important? That is the agenda of this video. So we have to understand the background of this particular news item. In 1965 and 1971, we have had wars. One with Pakistan and again in 1971 in the context of the Bangladesh Liberation War. So in the wake of both these wars, there was migration of people from India to Pakistan. So what they have done here is they have left behind their properties. Under the Defense of India rules, framed under the Defense of India Act 1962, the government of India took over the properties and companies of those who went to Pakistan and took up Pakistani nationality. So the same was done for property left behind by those who went to China after 1962. We have had a Indo-China war. After that also lot of people left to China. So it is in this context we have to understand the importance of Tashkent Declaration. So this Tashkent Declaration took place on 10 January 1966, and this had a clause which specifically said India and Pakistan would discuss the return of property and assets taken over by either side in connection with the conflict. But what happened was, in 1971 itself, Pakistan disposed all such enemy properties without any deliberation with our country. So India decided now to finally deal with this enemy property issue. Now in 1968, the Enemy Property Act was enacted. And as per this 1968 Act, even certain movable properties are also considered to be enemy properties. In 2017, Parliament passed the Enemy Property Amendment and Validation Act 2016. So what it basically did was, it defined enemy subject and enemy firm in a broader perspective. So before this amendment, if a particular person is a citizen of our country, he would not be treated as a enemy, and he would be allowed to take up all those properties even if his ancestors have left India and taken up foreign or enemy nationality. But after the amendment, they are not considered to be legal heirs, and their property would be taken over by our government. So in the context of our history, according to Defense of India Act in 1939, so you have to understand that when we were discussing the Enemy Property Act, in 1962 we have imposed the Defense of India Act 1962, but it is not the first time, it happened way before that. 1939, when there was World War, during that particular point of time, and even before that, when there were press regulations, Defense of India Act was considered to be the go-to rule for British. So during the World War II, Germany, Italy and Japan were considered to be or declared to be enemy countries. So this statement is right. And now coming back to the enemy property rights. Read this statement. The legal heir and successor of an enemy is not considered an enemy if he is a citizen of India. Until 2017 amendment, this was considered to be true, but not anymore. So only one is the right answer. Now if you haven't watched the previous video on important provisions of Representation of Peoples Act 1951 and important provisions that were in news, the previous video. Please go back to that. We have discussed these points in that particular article, and this is a sort of a revision. So please come back and post your answers in the comment section below along with an explanation. That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned for more such videos.